Some good questions that we can all consider, and that's kind of what we've been looking at and exploring over the last several weeks is, what would the church look like? How would it be different? What would its members look like if it actually functioned exactly like Jesus intended for it to function? Obviously, he has a plan for his church, but that's what we've been doing. We're in a series of messages entitled Unstoppable Church. Now, is the church Midway or this building? Those of you been here? No, it's definitely not. Who's the church? We are the church. If you know Jesus Christ, you are the church. And so to say that the church is unstoppable is to say that I'm unstoppable. Have you ever felt that way? A lot of times I don't feel quite that way. I don't feel very unstoppable, but Jesus created his church. He initiated, he started his church as a winning team. And he's going to come out on top, even though it doesn't feel like it. It feels like the church is stoppable and perhaps even losing at times. But he created it and said, say it with me if you know it, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. That's a winning team. That's an unstoppable church. And we're looking at the book of Philippians because there, Paul tells us what an unstoppable church looks like. We started by talking about the fact that an unstoppable church has to have the DNA of discipleship. A disciple is a follower of Jesus. We always use Matthew 4:19. It's where Jesus said, come, follow me, I will make you fishers of men. So a disciple is one that is following Jesus. Come, follow me. It's one that is being changed by Jesus. Jesus said, I will make you fishers of men, not you will become. I will make you fishers of men. Thirdly, a disciple is one that's committed to the mission of Jesus. I will make you fishers of men. He's got a purpose, and you're a part of that purpose. And in Philippians, and if you've got your Bibles, flip there to chapter 2 of the book of Philippians, toward the end of your Bibles there, the Apostle Paul writes this so that we can see a prescription or a picture, a portrait of what an unstoppable church looks like. So far in the series, we talked about the DNA of discipleship. That is the DNA of an unstoppable church, is discipleship. And so we're looking each week of the series at some element of discipleship. The second week, we looked at discipleship that's fueled by joy. Not happiness, but joy, because happiness comes and goes, but joy can last forever. And then last week, our pastor took us through a study of attitudes, the attitudes of discipleship. So hopefully you've come in today with an attitude adjustment, and you're ready to keep going. Today we're going to talk about real relational discipleship. Real relational discipleship, because discipleship at its core has to have relationships. Do you have any of those? One or two? Relationships, some of them are going well, some of them not so well. How many of you have ever crashed and burned in relationships before? Okay, some of you just did that this morning, and you're sitting beside the person whom you did that with, and that's okay. We've got some good news for you today. I've crashed and burned in relationships a lot, but I'll tell you, I'll make a confession. I crashed and burned pretty hard yesterday. We had a big college football day, and it was an awesome Saturday, and hopefully you were able to enjoy it. But how many of you, like me, were doing some laboring on Labor Day weekend? Anybody? Wow. Okay, I was pretty lonely, I guess. Okay, there's a few of you. Yeah. Y'all are some rested people. You should be able to listen really well today. I was working yesterday. I had my little 3-year-old son, Caleb, with me, and my dad and Caleb and I were working on a piece of equipment, and I was trying to pull a lever up, and so we decided to get some leverage, and so we put a pipe on the lever so that I could get a little leverage. Maybe you've done that before. It works pretty well, usually. For me, it didn't go so well. So I was pulling really hard trying to get that off, and I was standing in a bucket of a skid steer loader, and my ankle was right in the inside. My foot was right in the inside of the bucket, and I was pulling really, really hard, and I got a little bit too high up on the pipe. So what do you think happened as I'm pulling? The pipe slips right off, and how many of you like AFV, America's Funniest Videos? Anybody? That was me yesterday, and if it was caught on film, I could be a rich guy in the coming weeks for sure. But it slipped off, and it was the classic America's Funniest Videos moment. I flipped backwards, landed right on my back, and did what felt like 18 rolls. I know it was just one, but it felt like 18. And my little 3-year-old son, I looked up and saw his face, and he's going, and it was kind of one of those moments where he just sat there and looked at me until I went, it's okay, I'm good. I popped up, I said, I'm good. I'm a little swollen today, but I'm good. And then he goes, just starts laughing at me. But I crashed and burned. And so I wanted to confess that because they say confession is good for the soul. But in your relationships, don't you do that? Don't you go tumbling? Don't you go rolling sometimes? Well, Paul has been talking about how our relationship with Jesus transforms the church. In this passage of Philippians chapter 2, we're going to be starting in verse 14 in just a minute, but we looked at the first part of this passage, and Paul's talking about, it's a deep theological passage, just chock full of truth about how Jesus came and he humbled himself. He humbled himself to the point of death, even death on the cross. It even says he humbled himself to the point of being a bondservant or a slave. And how our relationship with him, if we follow after him and his example, will transform us. And then he just stops, and it's kind of weird almost if you just read through it, and it's like he stops and goes, but hold on, I also want to send these two guys to you, and man, these two guys I'm going to send to you are awesome. You're going to like them. You should love them. You should receive them. And you're kind of like, well, I thought we were talking about Jesus. And then the more you read it, you start to realize, hey, we are still talking about Jesus. These two people he's talking about are examples of Jesus and examples of relationships and examples of bearing light. And so that's what we're going to look at today. So tell me this, how many of you have a friend that's that friend who has always been there? Somebody popped in your mind. Raise your hand if somebody popped in your mind immediately. Almost all of us have at least one or two people that have kind of fit that. Ever since you've known them, they have been there through thick and thin. A lot of times you don't feel like you have those people too, I know. But Paul definitely did. Paul realized and understood that he had to have relationships. He had to have friends, people to rely on in his life. Paul had those relationships, and those relationships stood the test of time. Those relationships, those friendships, stood the test of trials, too. And if you've been here with us, tell me, where is Paul writing this letter from? From prison. He's in prison. And in Philippians, he was doing the same thing, yet he says, rejoice in the Lord, and again, I will say rejoice. And you think, what's wrong with this guy? In Ephesians, he's joyful there too. He talks about being in Christ, but he's in prison. What's wrong with him? First of all, he met Jesus, and that changed everything. We've been looking at that. But also, he met people who modeled their lives after Jesus, just like he was trying to do. His relationship stood the test of time and of trials, and he wrote to the church at Philippi. And so he's writing this stuff to the church. And so if you know Jesus today, he's writing this to you. If you don't know Jesus today, then you get a glimpse of what you could be a part of, an unstoppable church, a team that is going to win. And hopefully today, even if you're here checking it out, and if so, we're so glad that you're trying to see what Jesus is all about, what the church is really all about. You'll get a glimpse of that today and what it can do to our relationships. But in his writing, Paul wrote to the church at Philippi, he knew that having real discipleship, real relationships was essential to the church being unstoppable. In fact, Jesus even puts it this way, Matthew chapter 22, you don't have to turn there, but Jesus met a lawyer. And here's how the conversation kind of went. I'll paraphrase. The lawyer said, Jesus, he was going to trip him up, and he said, Jesus, what's the most important thing in the world to God? What he really asks is, what's the most important command in all the law? And many of you know it's known as the Great Commandment. Jesus said to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and then to love your neighbor as yourself. And so he said to love God and love people. And then he said, it's on those two commands that all of the prophets, all of the law hangs on. Everything hangs on that. That's what is most important to God. So really, what's most important to God? Jesus. Jesus says relationships. A relationship with God and a relationship with people. Jesus valued relationships, and Paul understood that, and that's where we're at today, and he gives us some good examples of that. Look at Philippians chapter 2, and we're going to read verses 14 and 15. We glazed over those some last week as well, but it sets the tone for what these people we're going to look at, Timothy and Epaphroditus. Two of Paul's friends, closest friends he ever met. One he describes as a son. Timothy he describes kind of as his son. And then Epaphroditus as his brother. So co-laborers in the ministry. And he's going to describe them in verses 19 through 30 that we'll read in a moment. But he describes them in this context, that they are bearers of light. And that's what he writes about here in verse 14. If you're ready for the word, say, uh-huh. Verse 14 says, do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless, children of God without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. You ever feel like that's the case when you look around? Then he says this, among whom you shine as lights. Among whom you shine as lights in the world. Let's talk about that word light for a minute. I looked it up. What's the real meaning of that word? What is phoster is how you would say the Greek word, but here's what it means. And I found some things I thought were very intriguing. Definitely it talks about a light, a brightness, a morning star even, those kind of languages. But this was the part that intrigued me the most is when you look at that word light, it also means a window, a window. And at first I'm kind of like, you know, a window, that's not very bright. A window just lets light, oh. What do windows do? They let light in. They help you see something. And here's what I think Paul wants us to get. And here's what I believe God wants to do in my life and yours today. He wants us to see our life as a window that's clear and transparent so that when people look at us, they see straight through us. They see who we are. They see how we relate to other people. They see how we relate to our Savior, Jesus Christ, so that, hear me, so that when they see us, they see through us straight to the light that is Jesus Christ. That's what our relationship should look like, that we're just a window. That's how we're a light. We're just a window that reflects the light of Jesus. How many of you know where the moon and the dark night sky, where does it get its light? Does it radiate from the inside? Does it have a burning ball somewhere inside of it? What does it do? Where does the light come from? It reflects the light of the sun. The sun is not seen. You can't see the sun at nighttime, or it wouldn't be nighttime. It wouldn't be dark anymore. But the moon sees the light of the sun and reflects it, and that's what we see, and that's how it stands out. And so today, if I were to give you a mirror, and in this mirror, I were to ask you to look in this mirror and see the reflection of yourself, the reflection of what your relationships look like, what would you be reflecting? A lot of things are probably come to mind. Some probably Jesus, some probably far from it. But what do you see when you look in the mirror? I see a lot. Sometimes more than I want to see. I see the outward appearance that maybe I don't like. But I'm talking about deeper than that. I'm talking about on the inside. A lot of times I look in the mirror and I don't see what I want to see looking back. I don't often see Jesus, but today I believe that we should be just like the moon. We should look in the mirror and we should just reflect. We should be a mirror, a window that reflects and lets in the light of Jesus. Every time you see yourself in this mirror, you should see Jesus looking back, and that is seen the most in your relationships, all of them, family, friends, parents, cousins, uncles, brothers, sisters, kids, coworkers, bosses. I could keep going. We have a lot of relationships. So that is what Paul wants us to understand. And so these two guys showed us what an unstoppable relationship, an unstoppable church can truly look like. The bottom line is this today. If you're taking notes, jot this down. The bottom line is that real relationships, not fake ones, we're going to talk about the difference. Real relationships are essential to true discipleship. Real relationships are essential to true discipleship. And as you're thinking about that, think about the Apostle Paul. How many of you would describe Paul as a spiritual giant, right? I mean, he's the man. He wrote most of the New Testament. God obviously liked him. He planted the church. It's fair to say that you and I would not be here today if God did not use the Apostle Paul the way that he used him. And if the Apostle Paul didn't do what he said to do. That's why the church is here. He was a spiritual giant. But get this, even the spiritual giant that we call the Apostle Paul knew that he had to have real, authentic relationships in his life, even beyond that of Jesus. Here, this is a big statement. Think about this. Jesus did not just die on the cross just so that we could have a relationship with him. That's where it starts. That's the foundation of all relationships, sure. But Jesus didn't die on the cross so that we could enter into a relationship with God, which is why he died. But he didn't die just so we could enter that relationship and then sit back, put our feet up, and enjoy it. Jesus died on the cross so that we could enter into a relationship with God the Father so that we could go and be a part of a team that's going to win, so that we could go and be a part of spreading the gospel, the good news of his name, making his name famous to all the world. And that means our relationship with other people. That's why they're so important. What's most important to God? It's relationships. It's a relationship with him and then a relationship with other people. Even the spiritual giant we call Paul understood that. And so in verses 19 through 20 of Philippians chapter 2, I'm going to read from the New King James Version if you want to do the same version there. Many people ask, what's the best version to use? And our answer goes back to what I heard our pastor say many, many years ago. It's the one you will read. So, but we'll be reading from the New King James Version if you want to follow along with the same version today. I want to give you four things. It's an acronym that goes with the letters R-E-A-L. How can you be real in your relationships? And Paul gives us a portrait, a prescription of this throughout Philippians chapter 2, verses 19 through 30. He's describing in the first part, all the way through verse 24, Timothy, his relationship with Timothy. Verses 25 through 30, he's describing his relationship with Epaphroditus, two very near and dear people to his heart. If you're ready for the word this morning, say amen. Starting in verse 19, he starts and talks about Timothy, and then I'll give you those four things we learn from this passage. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly, that I also may be encouraged when I know your state, for I have no one like-minded who will sincerely care for your state. Remember, he's writing to a church here, and so he's in prison. He can't be there with them. Verse 21, for all seek their own, not the things which are of Christ Jesus. You ever done that before? You got any friends that do that in your life? I know I do. I know I've done it. Verse 22, but you know his proven character, that as a son with his father, he served with me in the gospel. Therefore, I hope to send him at once, as soon as I see how it goes with me. See the uncertainty in Paul's life, a deep, dark moment that he's in. But I trust the Lord that I myself may also come shortly. Verse 25, we shift from Timothy to Epaphroditus. Yet I considered it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, but your messenger and the one who ministered to my need. Pause right there. You think Epaphroditus was a good friend or not? When I tell you this, it says that he was my fellow soldier, he was my fellow this, my fellow that. He was from the church at Philippi. He was one of their own. And they sent a monetary gift to Paul in prison to help sustain him and keep him going. And Epaphroditus was the messenger, the delivery boy, if you will. And you think, yeah, well, he hopped in the car and drove a couple of blocks down the road, and there he is. He traveled. He would have had to have traveled 700 miles to do so. Did you hear me? 700 miles. He was a 700-mile friend. Do you have any 700-mile friends? I'd like to think so. Are you a 700-mile friend? Boy, I hope so. I don't know, though. I don't know if I'd want to get Paul that money that bad. I'll be honest. That's a true friend. Just think about that, though. Moving on to verse 26. Since he was longing for you all, I guess so, traveling that far, and was distressed because you had heard that he was sick. Not because he was sick. He was distressed because they had heard that he was sick, and he knew they were worried. A selfless guy. Think about this. Verse 27, for indeed he was sick, almost unto death, but God had mercy on him, and not only him, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. Verse 28, therefore I sent him the more eagerly, that when you see him again, you may, what? Rejoice, and that I may be less sorrowful. Receive him, therefore, in the Lord with all gladness and hold such men in esteem, because for the work of Christ he came close to death, not regarding his life, to supply what was lacking in your service toward me. I've got a lot of friends that's like, yeah, I need somebody to supply what's lacking in their service towards me. They don't put me first, and I should be first. That's how we feel so many times. But he had two friends that were just that. They put Paul first. So let me give you four things we learned from these two gentlemen from this passage. Number one, they were reliable. Here's the R, reliable. Reliable. Are you a reliable friend? Do you have a reliable friend? Jesus is pretty reliable. Amen. He's been there every time I've needed him, without fail. And I'm sure glad. But he wants us to model our lives after him. We see in verse 22 that we just read, Timothy, it says, you know his proven character. He's consistent. You know his proven character. Epaphroditus, verse 25 that we just read, it called him a fellow worker, a fellow soldier. He ministered to me, he said. They were reliable. They were there for Paul. And I want you to write this down if you're taking notes. When you want to be reliable, a lot of you may want to see your relationships change, and you want to be that reliable person, and you want to change how you're perceived in your relationships, because maybe it's very needed. We all need that, by the way. You all need some makeovers in your relationships. I need makeovers in my relationships all the time. But write this down if you're taking notes. If you want to be reliable in your relationships, you have got to be rooted in your relationship with Jesus. You will never be reliable in your relationships with people if you're not rooted deeply in your relationship with Jesus. I think about all the times that I think, hey, I've been pretty reliable. I'm a reliable guy. That's every time I've been that guy in somebody's life, I always think back and I ask myself, why was I so reliable? And every time I ask myself that, I always come back to the same person, and his name's Jesus. The only times I'm truly a reliable, selfless person and consistent is when I'm focusing on Jesus Christ and not on me. You want to be reliable in your relationships, you've got to be rooted in Jesus. That's where it all begins. Paul understood that. Timothy understood that. Epaphroditus understood that. Paul was all about your identity in Jesus, wasn't he? In Ephesians, over and over, he says, in Christ, in Christ, in Christ. That's your identity. That's who you are. In Philippians, he talks about being in Christ, in Christ, in Christ. Every book that he wrote, every single letter he wrote, he was focused on identity. Here's why I believe. I believe that our identity leads to our initiatives. You're not going to start something new. You're not going to take initiative in some area of your life and relationships unless it fits your identity, unless you feel it's something that you're passionate about, something that you're called to. But when your identity is consumed and burned up by Jesus Christ and a passion for living life as a disciple of his, when that happens, your initiatives, all the things that you decide you're going to start, all the actions that you take are going to follow and look more like him. Otherwise, they're just going to look more like you. Do you want that? I don't want that. When I look in that mirror, I see what's looking back. That's the problem. There I am, and I don't want that. I want more of him. I don't want more of me. I want more of him. And that's how we can be reliable. Jesus even put it this way. Matthew chapter 5, verse 37, Jesus said, let your yes be yes and your no, no. For everything else is from the evil one. What was he saying? Be consistent. Be reliable. When you say something, mean it. Be truthful. Be honest. Be full of integrity. I don't know about you, but I've met a lot of people, and God forbid I might have ever been one of these people, probably so, that my yes is yes if something better doesn't come along. Hey, yeah, I'm going to come to that thing that I promised you I was going to come to last month, but I'll decide an hour before it starts because, that game may go a little bit long. That college football game you were watching yesterday, let your yes be, stop it. That's what Paul's saying, stop it. Jesus is saying, let your yes be yes, let your no be no, be consistent, be reliable. What if Jesus didn't let his yes be yes and his no be no? It would be an awful place to live, wouldn't it? Life would be terrible, but his yes was yes. When he said, I'm going to die on the cross, even when he was broken and his sweat turned to blood, that's how distraught he was. He did not back down from his yes. He told God, yes, I'm going to go to the cross for these people that don't deserve it. And even though I'm so distraught and to the point of death, and he was so distraught that he was sweating blood, he still said, my yes is yes, and I'm going to follow you, Lord. I'm glad he did. It's a good example for us. Paul was that guy. Timothy was that guy as well. Here's a harsh truth that we talked about some in this series, and it's this, that many people, if you're a believer today and you know Jesus, many people are going to gather their perspective of what the church is like by their interactions with you. It's a scary thought, isn't it? That's not fair, is it? That's what we say. It's like, well, that's not fair. They're not all like me. And some of us are like, yeah, it's a good thing. It's a good thing they're not all like you. But here's the thing. You're going to be the only Bible some will read. You'll be the only Jesus some will ever see. That's why your relationships matter so very much. People are going to, and I've met these people. They say, I'm never going to church. And I say, why? I met those people. And people say, I'm not going to church because there's people there, and I've met them, and they're awful. Don't be that person. Don't be that. That's what Paul is saying here. Don't be that guy. Be reliable. To those who have caused that, Paul's saying, just don't do that. Be reliable. Be like Timothy. Be like Epaphroditus. I want to speak, though, to some of you who may have come today, and you're like, that's me. I didn't want to come today because I've met those people. They're all hypocrites. Usually when people say that, I say, hey, one more won't hurt. Come join the party. But I won't say that today. I'm not saying that today. I do want to address those of you who feel that way, though. If you feel like, hey, I can't come to church because I've met those people and they stabbed me in the back, and I've met so many, and I've been stabbed in the back by people at church, I want to challenge you with something that has radically changed me. Don't let imperfect people be the foundation from which you shape your view of an unstoppable church that Jesus started. Amen. Look at Jesus. It's not their church. It's not my church. It's not the pastor's church. We looked at this last week. It's not the deacon's church. It's not your church or my church. It's his church. Amen. He started it. It's his idea. It's his church. So look at him. You want to see what the church is really like? Look at Jesus. Don't let people mess it up for you. But people do mess church up for some people. because that perception is out there. So be a good perception. Be reliable. Be encouraging. The church is not called to be comfortable or convenient. The church is called to be uncomfortable and do whatever it takes to reach people for his name. That's what God has called us to be. This is where you talked about apathetic attitudes last week. This is where apathy turns into availability. You feel like, I'm not equipped to have good relationships. Yes, you are. If you know Jesus, you have everything you need. Hear me. Some of you have been saying this the whole time I'm talking. I can't be reliable because of A, B, C, D, E, and you're listing it out. You have everything you need in Jesus to have relationships that are godly and true and real. Be reliable. Number two, Timothy in verse 19, it says, Paul said he would be cheered or encouraged by him. In verse 28, he talks of Epaphroditus, and he says, when you see him, rejoice. So number two, the E word here is edifying. The Bible uses the word edify a lot. Here's what that word means. It means to instruct or benefit, but mainly to uplift. To uplift. You have some people in your life that just, when you're around them, you're just drawn to them. It's like, man, I just want to be around you. Every time I'm around you, that smile, you just radiate something that I want more of. I just want to be around you. I want to be more like you. And they pull you in, right? You know some people like that. You also know some of those people, it's like you see them coming and you go, and you turn the other way. It's like, I've probably been that guy. You've probably seen me coming. It's like, there he comes, turn, let's go that way. You're in Walmart, and you jump down the other aisle, whatever it might be. Don't be that guy, don't be that girl. Be an edifying person. The people who you don't want to be around, they're probably not very edifying, I'm guessing. Probably not very reliable, but they're definitely not very edifying. They're definitely not very uplifting. Timothy and Epaphroditus were uplifting to Paul, even in his darkest moments. I want to give you a statement that I believe with all my heart, and I hope it shapes us as a church, at least just a little bit today. The statement is this, that I believe that the church should be the most edifying, encouraging, and exciting organization in the entire world. Amen. Jesus is the hope of the world, but he sent his church to be that hope on his behalf. You wear the name of Jesus, and the things we have in Jesus are incomparable to anything you can find in this life. So why would we ever have a frown in the church? And I'm not talking about that fake church smile that we often wear. We fight on the way to church, you know it, and you go like this as soon as you get out, and you got to wear the smile. I'm talking about a real smile that radiates Jesus because you have joy. Everything around you could be crumbling. Your finances could be in shambles. You may have just lost somebody. You may have lost a job. But you have joy all over your face, just like Paul, where he says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Why? Because you know Jesus. Amen. Because you're uplifted by that edifying relationship with God. And then by people. That's why I believe the church should be the most edifying, exciting organization in the world. People should never look at you and go, man, I don't want to be a part of that, if that's how everybody is. They should look at you and say, man, you're always so joyful. Why? Well, let me tell you about that. I know Jesus. And they say, well, hey, wherever you're getting this from, I want some. Where do I find it? And you say, come with me on Sunday, I'll introduce you. Or better yet, you say, hey, let's talk about that right now. Let's sit down at lunch, and I want to share it with you right now, how God transformed my life through Jesus. Timothy and Epaphroditus were there for Paul, not just when it was easy, even when he was in prison. They were edifying and encouraging to him. I want to ask you this, how many meaningful conversations have you had lately, even today? You know, so many times in the hallways, even here, we're on our mission, right? We're like this. We talk about this a lot around here, but we're focused. We're going to our place. We're going to sit in our seat. And if somebody's sitting there, I'm going to be a sourpuss and I'm not going to smile, but I'll still wear my church smile anyway. But on the inside, I'm going to be mad, and I'm focused down, and people walk by you over and over. Even here, how much more so in the world, but even here at Midway in these hallways, people walk by you that maybe you could just be that one smile that they needed, that one little encouragement, that one, how are you doing today? And then here's the question. A lot of you are like, what if I do that? I might embarrass myself. You probably will. I've done it many times, but we've come up with a solution for that for you. A lot of times it's like, well, I'm afraid I'm going to say, hey, you must be a first-time guest here. And they say, I've been here 10 years. You're afraid of that. So what's the question that we've been trained on for years and years that we ask people in the hallways? How long have you been coming to Midway? So at least here, that's a real simple, because you can't go wrong with that. If they're a first-time guest, they're probably going to say, hey, it's my first day. If they're not a first-time guest, some of you, hopefully somebody's asked you that if you're a first-time guest today. If not, I'm asking you now. So there you go. Now somebody else is going to ask you. I want to challenge you. Do that with three people before you leave today. That's my challenge. Ask them that question. How long have you been coming to Midway? Again, it's their first time. They're going to tell you. If they've been here 5 years, they'll say, yeah, I've been here about 5 years. How about you? Well, I've been coming so long. Cool. Are you in a life group? No? Okay, well, come to mine. And then it just goes from there. How life-changing could that be? It seems simple. But how many times do we do it? And how many times do we just look down? And we're not edifying to people because we're just got our blinders on and we're not looking at anything but what we want, what we need, and what we are after. Be reliable, be edifying. By the way, Hebrews 13:2, great passage about being edifying and reaching out to strangers, says, don't forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. Think about that. Be reliable, be edifying. Number three, be authentic. Be authentic. Remember I said be a window? Being a light means being a window. There's one common characteristic of a window. Even if it's tinted, it's still clear. You still see through a window. Be authentic. Be clear. Be real. I'll be honest, this is the hardest one for me. I'm kind of introverted at heart. I'm very independent. I just soon go through life by myself and be left alone. And you're like, well, I did like him. I don't really like him anymore. That's who I am at my core. I like quiet time. I like sitting around just looking at the sky, whatever it might be. I'm that guy. I don't like being authentic with people. I'll be honest with you. Because then I have to let them in, and then they know all my stuff, and I don't want them to know all my stuff. And that's why I've led life group after life group, not just here at Midway, but in past churches with other jobs, whatever it is. And I'll be honest with you, I haven't really been, this is a confession, I've already confessed that I crashed and burned yesterday, but this is even more of a confession. I have not really been real and authentic and transparent in any life group setting until last year. Ministry complicated that for me, and I felt like, well, I can't let people in. Then I'll be preaching, and they'll know all my junk. Because guess what? I have it too. I struggle in life too, just like you. We're all human. We're all people, and that's why we've got to be able to be real and authentic. And God's transformed my life this past year with our disciple shift process because I've opened up to people and let people in. And guess what? It's not so bad. It still hurts, but man, has it helped me because I've got people I can rely on, just like Paul relied on Timothy and Epaphroditus. They were authentic. We got to be authentic in our relationship with God. Here's something that's going to help some of you today. A lot of you feel like life is confusing and frustrating and chaotic right now, and you've got a ton of questions for God. But you say, but I can't question God, so I'm going to keep that to myself, so maybe he won't hear me. I want to let you in on a little secret. God already knows. He's in your head. He knows what's going on up here. But so many times we feel like we can't be real and authentic with God. I've learned something about God, and I want to share it with you today, and it's very practical and simple. And that one thing is this. God's big enough to handle your questions. Yes, in a perfect world with perfect faith, we would never question God. Let me know when you get there, because I hadn't got there yet. Amen. I have questions for God, and every time I ask him, God doesn't smite me, strike me down, and never listen to me again. He just compassionately, patiently listens. Sometimes he answers the way I think he'll answer. Sometimes he doesn't. But every time, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he's big enough to handle your questions. So be authentic. Be real with God. Be authentic and real, secondly, with other people in your relationships with other people. Paul was that way. He let us in, didn't he? When you read his letters, don't you see a real guy? He tells you all about himself, all of his struggles, and the joy that still comes from knowing Jesus. He tells us all about that stuff. I believe today we're in a world that's so connected, isn't it? We're connected by social media. We can see what's going on. You've seen, if you're friends with me on Facebook, I may not have talked to you in 6 months, but you know a lot of stuff that's happened in my life because we're connected by Facebook, and I'm a fan of all that. I'm on all that stuff. But I believe today we're in a world that's more connected than ever, but we're in a world where we're the loneliest we've ever been. Amen. That's not an indictment on social media. I love all that stuff. It's a great way to be connected, but it doesn't give you the authentic and real and transparent kind of relationship that Paul's describing with Timothy and with Epaphroditus. You've got to have a real connection with people. Amen. We're so lonely. I think about lonely people in the Bible, and I'll be honest, the loneliest people, I think one of the loneliest groups of people in all the Bible is the Pharisees. They were prestigious. They were religious. They were well-respected. They were loved. They were looked at on a pedestal. They're way up here, and I view myself way down here. They knew more than everybody else. But here's the thing about their relationships. If you look at how they related to people, everything they did, not everything they did, they were certainly some good people at times, but overall, the stuff they did was fake. There's a reason Jesus called them a whitewashed tomb. You're pretty on the outside, but dead on the inside. They were fake. And here's what happens. If you're fake in what you put out in relationships, then what do you think what you're going to get back is going to be? Is it going to be real? It's going to be just as fake, if not more so. And here's what that leads to. It leads to fear in your relationships because you're lonely and afraid. And then you just get intimidation back. I could put this perfect picture of who I am, and some of you may be intimidated by me. But where does that get me? That's the Pharisees. That's being the hypocrite that they were, that whitewashed tomb that looks so good on the outside, but on the inside, they're broken and confused and missing the whole mark of what Jesus came to do and what he built his church to be. Unfortunately, I think that fits so well people in the church today. Amen. We like to look good on the outside, but man, we can't let people know all this stuff because, man, it's ugly. I don't want anybody to know that, but Paul let people in. Timothy and Epaphroditus were friends that were authentic and that were real. And here's a statement that I think will change how you approach your relationships. Hope you write it down if you're taking any notes. And here's the statement. It's not how good we are that counts, but how truthful we are about how good we are not. It's not how good we are that counts, but how truthful we are about how good we're not. And I'm just guessing that if you take that approach to your relationships, you're authentic in that kind of a way, you'll probably become an even better person. The good that you would have listed will probably grow. It's probably going to affect everything that you do. Relationships can only grow in the messy, authentic, real dirt of authentic community with other believers and with non-believers. You build a relationship. People think that you can only have community with them. Jesus ate with sinners, and he built relationships there, but they were all rooted in his relationships with his Father and with other people. Be reliable, be edifying, be authentic. Last thing is be last. Timothy and Epaphroditus were selfless. They were humble. They were last. They were reliable, edifying, authentic, and they were also last. Timothy, in verses 21 and 22, it says, and you probably have some relationships like this, they all seek their own interests, not those of Jesus. But Timothy, he talks of him and says, but he has served with me. He didn't do that. He was different. Epaphroditus, verse 30, probably my favorite verse of this passage, verse 30, it talks of Epaphroditus. It says, for the work of Christ, he came close to death, not regarding his own life. How would it change our relationship, first of all with God, but also with other people, if we didn't regard our own life, but put ourselves last? By the way, the Bible says something about he who is first will be last, and he who is last will be... It's almost like God likes that kind of mentality. Jesus modeled that. It says in the beginning of chapter 2, he modeled that by making himself a slave, humbling himself to the point of death, even death on a cross. He didn't have to do that. But his yes was yes, and he went for it, and he gave us a reason to live. He gave us a reason to be a part of this team. He put himself last so that we could be first, and now he asks us to do the same. Will you put yourself last so that others can be first? Put me first so that others can understand who I really am. That's how we're a part of the unstoppable church. The more last you become, the more loving you're going to be. We feel like it's the opposite, don't we? If I get what I want, I can be more loving then. No. The more you put yourself last, the more you look like Jesus, the more you pick up that mirror and you look at it and you realize, hey, I see Jesus and I'm just going to reflect Jesus. The more loving you are, the more like Jesus you are, the more loving you'll become. The more last you are, the more loving you can become. I want to share this with you. This is a check. A lot of you write these a lot. Some of you write more of them than you need to if you're like some of us. But it's blank. Now, when you write a check, you'll sign it. But only after you do a couple of things. You write who it's to. You write how much it's for. Because, man, Lord knows, I don't have more than that. Right? You write how much it's for, and you date it. Sometimes we even post-date it. Because it's like, hey, I will have this much, but I don't yet. So wait and cash it till a little bit later, because then I'll have it. So we have all these stipulations on checks. And I believe that our life as a follower of Jesus, as a disciple, should just be a blank check. That we should live life as a blank check. We say, Jesus, I'm going to sign this check of my life, and you fill out the rest. You tell me who to minister to. You tell me what to do. You tell me how much to give, how much of my resources, how much of my time. You tell me what you want, Jesus, who it's to. You fill in all the details, and I'm just going to sign it, and I'm going to give myself away. I think that's the way that we should approach our relationships. My relationships with God, God gave me better than a blank check. God gave me Jesus. He gave me hope. He gave me peace. He gave me contentment. He gave me joy. Best of all, he gave me salvation that I can't get apart from him. He's given me everything. Why would I not live my life as a blank check and just sign it and say, God, do with it whatever you want. If it's more than I've got, then you just give me what you need me to have and I'll go do whatever you ask me to do in any relationship, even with that person, that one that drives me nuts. I'll even go talk to them. I'll even do whatever you ask me to do in any relationship. I'll reconcile. I'll put myself last. I'll be reliable. I'll be edifying. I'll be authentic and I'll be last. I'm a blank check. Just take me, use me as whatever you want me to be. God loves that kind of spirit. Earlier in Philippians chapter 2, it talks of Jesus and how he humbled himself. And starting in verse 8, look there with me. We'll finish with this, but I think it's the culmination of all of this. We've looked at these examples. But beginning in verse 8 of Philippians 2, it says, "And being found in appearance as a man," talking of Jesus, "he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore," here's what God does with that kind of attitude, that blank check kind of mindset. "Therefore, God has also highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name." Verse 10. "That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father." You look around today, and it feels like the church is losing. Evil is everywhere. And my heart breaks when I see the way the church is being persecuted, the way evil's winning, it feels right now. Words really don't describe it, does it? And I know you feel like I do in that. And we can do some things. We can pray, and we've talked about some of those things we can do. But here's what I want to tell you today. Even when it feels like, and you probably feel that way in your own life, not just when you look around in the world and the evil that's taking place, but inside your relationships and in your own life, you feel like it's broken and things are just falling apart sometimes. I know you do. That passage that talks about the name of Jesus answers it all. The church feels stoppable and like it's losing sometimes when you look around, but here's what I want you to know. In your life and in the world, Jesus is still the name above every name. God is still on his throne. Nothing surprises him. He sees everything that's going on. Yes, it confuses us as to why this is happening, why he's not doing this about it, whatever it might be in your own life or in the context of the world as a whole. At the name of Jesus, you mark it down, every knee, evil knees, healthy knees, it doesn't matter who you are, who you want to follow, at the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that he is Lord. And that's a real truth for the world today, but it's also a real truth for you in your life. So my question is this, as we wrap up today, is are you going to kneel? Are you going to bow now? Or are you going to bow later? It's a tough question. Some of us don't like swallowing that kind of thing because we don't like being told what to do, but every knee's going to bow, folks. Every tongue's going to confess. So my thing is, I want to just bow now. I want to live a life that's just like this. I'm going to be on my knees. There's something about this posture. In just a minute, we're going to sing, and I hope some of you will do just this in your own life, either at your seat or come kneel up here, but get on your knees, bow before the name that's above every name, and it's going to transform your relationship with God. It's going to transform your relationship with other people. You can be real and edifying and authentic and last in such a way that it'll change your entire life for the better. So will you join me on your knees? We're going to pray in a minute, and our band's going to come play, and I want you to worship. Maybe get on your knees before God and say, Jesus, I need you to be first in my life. Some of you haven't even taken that step and made him first. You haven't even said, Jesus, I want to give you my life. I am a blank check. Some of you have been, hear me, some of you have been post-dating your check. I'll give my life to Jesus. I'll get saved. You can call it whatever you want, but I'll give my life to Jesus when I feel like I've had a little bit of time to grow, when I get some things squared away and straightened out in my life, it won't happen. That's what I want to tell you. It won't happen. Amen. Just be a blank check. Jesus will give you what you need. Some of you feel that way, that you already know Jesus, and in your relationships, you're post-dating some checks. Well, I'll call them and apologize when they do this. I'll move forward with what you're asking me, God, when you fill in the blank. Will you be a blank check today? Sign it and say, God, do with me whatever you want. Bow your heads with me for just a minute. And most important thing you can do today is that if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, you don't know that if you were to die today, you would go to heaven, I want to give you a chance to do that. Be that blank check and say something like this. I want you to know a prayer doesn't save you. Prayer is just the way we talk to God. And I'm so glad that we have that. But prayer doesn't save you. Your heart and the condition of your heart, you saying, I am a blank check. I believe, Jesus, you died for me and that you're alive, paying for my sin in a way that I couldn't do. And Jesus, I want to give you all of me. I've been giving you little bits and pieces, but I give you all of me today. Will you save me and forgive me? Some of you need to do that right now in this place. And I want to give you a moment to do it in your own words. I'm not going to lead you in a prayer. You just do that. Talk to Jesus on your own right now. Would you do that if you don't know him? Christians that are here today, you're praying and asking how you can be a blank check in your relationships, both with God and with other people. Some of you, though, are praying that prayer, and you've just invited Jesus into your heart and into your life for the very first time. Nobody's going to come get you or embarrass you, but I want to just pray for you right now. If that's you, if you said, hey, Pastor, I prayed, received Jesus, I gave him my life today for the first time, I want to pray for you. Will you lift your hand up? Nobody's going to come embarrass you. We'll just lift it up. Say, pray for me, Pastor. That's me. I prayed to receive Jesus. I'm his for the first time. Raise your hand. Raise it high. Just want to pray for you. I see you, ma'am. Anybody else? I see you, sir. God bless you. Anybody else? I don't want to miss you. I see you, sir. Praise God. Keep him up. Anybody else? I don't want to miss you. Raise it, raise it high. Thank you. You can put your hands down. God bless all of you for doing that. Jesus, thank you for saving these souls. Because in your word, you don't say if and or but we do this, then you'll save us. You say if we confess in our heart that Jesus is Lord, we shall be saved. Satan's going to tell these people that it wasn't real, but I know it was real because you are real and you are truthful. Thank you for that. May it just be the beginning today. God, I pray that those who know you and need to be baptized would take that step, fill out the card they received when they came in so that we can help them on that journey. I pray that believers, people that are already following Jesus, would follow him better in their relationships because of the truth we've learned about today. Thank you for what you're doing in this place, Jesus. We pray it all in your holy and blessed name. And everybody said, amen. I want to ask you to stand with me. We're going to begin singing. I want you to use this as a time of worship. Some of you need to come and pray. The altar's open. Grab somebody, pray in your seats. But if you came to know Jesus today, you need to be baptized today, find a life group, get the card you received when you came in. Fill it out so we can follow up with you and walk with you this upcoming week. But as we sing, we still have plenty of time. We want to use this as a time to respond to Jesus because he's doing something in your life, isn't he? He's showing you some new stuff that maybe you haven't realized before, maybe even about you, that you need to change. So as we sing right now, will you let us know what God's doing? I'm going to be down here at the end of this song if you want to bring it to me then, but bring your cards and just lay them here. Come and pray together. Whatever God's leading you to do, take that step right now as we sing.